So good morning. Today's lecture will focus on synthetic biology. Have you all heard the word synthetic biology before earlier? What does it mean to you?
Synthetic? Well, it's not made up.
It's made up, it's synthetic. It's created by using artificial methods.
Yeah.
But why is synthetic biology so relevant in today's world? This scenario.
Because we are creating something that not using the natural resources, not dependent too much on the natural resources.
Something to that effect, yeah.
Yeah.
So what happened is that early on there was no concept of synthetic biology. When we needed to construct, as you see during the recombinant protein expression class, we focused on PCR or cDNA synthesis, and we retrieve the gene, we insert it into a plasmid, and then we express the gene. Now there's a limitation for this, you cannot exceed a certain number of genes in a plasmid. So we need to have a new method to synthesize genes, or basically construct genes from scratch. So one of the breakthroughs came when they developed method for oligonucleotide synthesis. Your primer, which you use in your lab, is actually a synthetic DNA molecule. But the bigger breakthrough came when J. Craig Venter, you have heard of J. Craig Venter? JCVI, they have a J. Craig Venter Institute. So he invented the world's first synthetic bacterium. So what he did is he took an existing bacterium, deleted the genome, created a synthetic genome and inserted back into the bacterium. So this was the first attempt to create a synthetic organism. But now synthetic biology has expanded into other fields. One of the key areas is in bioengineering is codon optimization. If you want an E. coli to produce protein at very high concentrations, you can actually use synthetic biology to modify the protein. Okay, you modify the gene sequence and you get a modified protein which will be expressed in E. coli. The other application for this is, in, for instance, in something known as morpholinos. Have you heard of morpholinos? Morpholinos are synthetic RNA molecules which you can inject into living systems and regulate other RNA. So suppose you have cancer, for instance, and then certain RNA molecules in the cell are associated with cancer. You want to silence these molecules. So what do you do? You can inject RNA. But if you inject RNA into the cell, the RNA will be degraded by the cellular machinery. So what you do is you create something known as a morpholino. Morpholino is an RNA with a synthetic backbone. So when you inject this morpholino into a cell, the cell RNAs cannot recognize it. It's a foreign molecule, it's synthetic. So it cannot degrade it. So it remains in the cell and it does its job, where it elicits its function. It will bind to the other RNA molecule and it can switch off cancer. Okay. So synthetic biology has advanced. In fact, on BBC just last week, there was a news of the first patient who has been injected with CRISPR. You know, he is used, if you have diseases, you can knock out the disease from your genome. Even in your state, in your adult state, you can knock off. So what they did, they injected the CRISPR gene to knock off a specific element in his genome, and they can regulate his phenotype based on his genotype. So these things are happening now. So synthetic biology is becoming more and more relevant in today's world. So what are we going to learn about today? So in synthetic biology, we have something known as the parts registry. The parts registry is a website. You can go online and you can just Google iGEM. So iGEM, and then from iGEM you can link to parts registry. What the parts registry is a synthetic repository. Okay. So generally when you want to buy stuff, you go online and you can purchase it on your website. You just go online, you pay. So the synthetic biology component are stored in a parts registry. You can go online, you can select your component and you can buy it. Okay. It will come to your standard on the plasmid. You can buy all the genes which you want on plasmids. In fact, the reason why they made a synthetic biology consortium is because they need to create an open source registry. You know, if you want to synthesize a gene and it's 1 KB, 1,000 bases, you need to pay around $300 to $400 to synthesize this gene. But not all people can afford to buy a $300 to $400 gene. So what they did, they made the synthetic biology and they did the parts registry. So in the parts registry, you can purchase genes. but they are at a minimal cost. You just some of the genes, you just have to pay shipping. So once you become a member, you pay a one-time fee and then you can ship. So it's a two-way process. So when you develop your genes, you upload. You send your gene in the plasmid, and then when you want to receive, you download. So it's a two-way process. So using this approach, you can develop your synthetic gene construct. So you don't have to keep reinventing certain genes. For instance, some genes have been synthesized, but if you do the synthesis again, it's redundant. So you can buy or retrieve the genes from the patch registry. So in the patch registry, right, they have adopted an electronic technology. You know, in electronic, when you do electronics, you have resistor, transistor, capacitor, and then you have the PNP, NPN transistor. So similarly, in the patch registry, you have different names for parts. So they are called components and devices. For instance, in your remember I told you about gene promoter binding site, ribosome binding site, gene coding sequence, and then termination sequence. So these are all, they are designated as components in the registry. So you can look through the registry and you can find, for instance, promoters, reporters, terminators, they are all in the registry. So you can mix and match. And when you join parts together, it's called a device. For instance, if I have a transistor, resistor, capacitor, and an induction coil, I join them together, I can make a radio. Okay, so that becomes a device. In this one, you join promoter, RPS, gene, and then you join the terminator, and you have a gene, that's a device. So that's why the terminology is slightly different in synthetic biology. So they are called parts and devices. So when you want to construct this device, how do you do it? Can you guess how you will join or construct a device? Suppose I want to construct a radio. I buy a breadboard, a circuit board, and then I buy the different parts, and then I join it using a soldering iron. How do you do it in this case? How do you join genes?
Ligase.
Precisely. You can use ligase to join genes. However, in some cases, the genes may be multiple components. You cannot use ligase. Ligase is very ideal for joining two genes which have overlapping fragments, or overlapping end. In this case, you need to use assembly TCR. So that's one of the key techniques which you will be studying in today's lecture. It's called Gibson assembly. I have uploaded a YouTube for you all, which is specifically dedicated to Gibson assembly. It's a very short procedure, but it's a revolutionary procedure because you can assemble large genomes using Gibson assembly. Okay, as you mentioned and as we discussed earlier, synthetic biology is based on development of de novo molecules. So, for instance, if you have an enzyme molecule which exists in nature and it performs a certain role, for instance, you have cellulase, it's degrading cellulose, okay, into its components, but you want to make a more advanced or more efficient version of cellulase, you can actually create it using synthetic biology. All you need to do is modify the active domain of the enzyme. So maybe in nature that does not exist, so you created a new element, which is a new molecule, right? This can be patented. So that's where the industrial application comes in. Many of the synthetic molecules can be patented, except those which are open source, which you cannot patent. But once you have a synthetic molecule, you have a new design, it works, you can patent it. Take, for instance, a viral coat protein. A viral coat protein is very difficult to retrieve because it's produced by virus. You'll have to obtain cDNA, you'll have to reverse transcribe, clone and express. But suppose you had the sequence online at the gene bank. You can download the sequence, you can select a region which you need to clone and express, you create a synthetic molecule. And you can codon optimize. Once you codon optimize, the DNA sequence will change. And once the DNA sequence changes, it becomes your IP. It's like a book. You have all the words, you combine them together, you copyright, you have a book. That's what's happening in synthetic biology. And if you have many genes together, you can have a new organism. And you can copyright it. So this is opening up new door for commercialization. That's why it's become established as a field in the current scenario.
Doctor, like for the viral coat protein, why don't they just inject the synthetic?
That's the basis for plasmid DNA vaccine. what they do is they find you have your viral coat protein, not all of it is immunogenic. You won't elicit an immune response. You can use bioinformatics algorithm to screen for specific domain which will elicit an immune response. You create sub-molecules. For instance, you have your amino acid 300 amino acid long, you just make 100, 100, 100. You take 100, you clone them into plasmid with a promoter which is working, which will function in a, for example, a mouse system. You inject them into mice and check for antibodies. It's being done all the time. Okay? So that's how they develop the modern vaccines, using plasmids. Because when you inject a plasmid into mice, you will have an immune response to the plasmid as well, because DNA. However, there will be a response to the protein which will be expressed as well. So usually in mice, you can use the CMV promoter. Okay, so these are some of the examples. For example, bacteria can be used as sensors to detect chemical molecules. Okay, so if you fuse, for example, if I have a promoter which is heat-driven promoter fused to a fluorescent protein, when a certain temperature is attained, the bacteria will fluoresce. Now, what's the application for that? You can use it for instance, monitoring temperature in a cold chain. You can have this bacterial protein in the system, and it will monitor the temperature. For instance, if the temperature during transit exceeded a certain time, you can actually see it because the bacteria will be growing. Okay, so things like that can be done. Viruses, as you mentioned, viral plasmids used for injection. Then bacterial cells which are engineered to secrete proteins in response to environmental cues. This relates to bacteria. For instance, you want to have a bacterium which will remain in the soil, you have it in your garden, and only under certain circumstances, when there is an environmental change, it will secrete a plant growth hormone. Bacteria produce auxins. Okay, maybe you can adjust the concentration of nitrogen in the soil, and then the bacteria will release the hormone, and it won't release under other circumstances. So these things are regulated. So all of this can be done by using the right promoter. As I mentioned earlier, the promoter is the switch. You use the right promoter, you can do the right. You can switch on. It's a switch. Yeah, that's why they look at it as electronic format, right? It's in silico format. So you can switch on and switch off pathway in response to stress and things of that nature. Yeah, so as I mentioned, you have paths, devices, and functions. So when you have paths, promoters, ribosome binding sites, gene coding sequences are all designated as parts. The term is parts. Devices are when you combine things together. So a reporter will be, for instance, the fluorescent protein conjugated to a heat shock protein, and then you have a promoter which will be driven by heat. For example, if the temperature increases, the fluorescent protein will express. If the temperature decreases, it will express things of that kind. That's a device. But devices can be more complex. For instance, a device can be DNA, a plasmid DNA, which you can insert into your system, into a human system. It will only target cells which have a cancer. That's where it becomes more complex. For instance, there may be cancer cells may be secreting certain factors. You can have promoters which are turned on by these factors. So you inject your whole system with plasmid, carrying the killer cell, killer protein for the cancer cell. And when it goes through your body, it finds the cancer-causing cells. It basically expresses only when it's in contact with cancer cells and not in contact with other cells, purely based on the signal molecule. The signal molecule from the cancer cell will bind to which region of the DNA? The promoter binding site. And then it will switch on or elicit a response. You can do those things, and they are being done now in experimental stage. Okay, so this is the basic structure of the gene. As you can see, this you should remember or retain it. So you have the blue, which is your promoter, and then you have your green start and stop codon, and you have your synthetic gene coding sequence. Okay, now when coming back down to the parts registry, when you buy parts from the registry, they are always shipped on plasmids. Can you tell me why they are shipped on plasmids and not as PCR products?
It's easily degraded.
Yes, correct. So if you have a PCR product, it's more likely to degrade. And then when you receive the PCR product, you need to clone it onto a plasmid in order to amplify it. Because PCR is prone to error. So even if you use proofreading, you may get error when you do a PCR. So they are shipped on plasmids, and you can receive the plasmid on a 96-well plate. You can receive 96 plasmids, you transfer them into E. coli. You can clone, express, purify, and will recover your plasmid. Now, in order to standardize, they make a standard restriction site on the plasmid. Okay. So when you receive your plasmid, it will have these standard restriction sites. When you send the plasmid, you construct your own, you need to incorporate the same restriction sites. Can you tell me why? It's like this. You have traveled, when you travel to different countries, have you seen your plug point?
Yeah.
Okay. When you come to Malaysia, it's one. You go to Japan, another. You go to Indonesia, another. And then you go to Europe. Different countries may have their own. So there is no interoperability. You have to buy a new adapter. So just imagine how many enzymes there are. We have about 300 to 400 restriction enzymes. If everyone put in his or her own restriction enzyme, when you receive these plasmids, you'll have a big job because you have to buy all the enzymes. In order to ensure interoperability and compatibility, they have provided you with restriction sites, which are standard. You have ECOR 1, NOT 1, XPA 1, SPA 1, NOT 1, and PST 1, which are all standard enzymes which are available in most labs. So the reason why they give you multiple enzymes is if your gene has a restriction site internally, you need to eliminate that and use the one which is compatible. For instance, the green is the gene. If it had an XPA1 site which will cut in the center of the gene, I will not use XPA1, I will use the alternative. So when you receive your plasmid, you want to make a new synthetic device. All you do is you grow your plasmid, you culture it, and then you purify, extract, and then you join. So you can join it all together and fuse. So that makes it simple. So this is what you will find when you visit the PATH registry. They have a standard set of restriction enzymes. Okay, so when you want to construct a promoter, do I need to buy a part from PATH registry? A promoter is a short piece of DNA, a short sequence, maybe 20, 30, 40 bases. So it's a promoter binding site. So if you want to construct a promoter, all you do is synthesize two primers, put them in a PCR tube, you fuse them together by annealing and denaturation. So you just fuse and then you have your promoter. Because promoter is only 20 to 40 bases, promoter binding site. So you can actually create a small molecule. Your PCR oligo, you can synthesize up to 60 bases. It's cheaper. But if you order the promoter, it's more expensive because you'll have the minimum size for orders is about 200 bases in the current scenario. So it's easier to identify a promoter, develop or synthesize two oligos, and then you just ligate or join them together in a PCR tube. So you have a forward and reverse and you join them together. Okay, so when you look through the PATH registry, you will see a symbol like this, which is an arrow. So this is the symbol for the promoter. Okay, generally when we designate in most textbooks, you will see an arrow facing forward. That's a sign of promoter, and an arrow facing in the reverse direction, which is a terminator. So in the PATH registry, you will see the symbol, which is designates a promoter. So among the promoters, you have many types of promoters. First one is constitutive. As the name suggests, the promoter will work under all circumstances. Whether you induce it, you don't induce it, it's still working. So in the human body, right, for instance, housekeeping genes are expressed using constitutive promoters. The second one is positively regulated. Positively regulated means when you give the cell a certain cue, the gene will express. For instance, bacteria, heat shock. I give the bacteria heat shock, they will express the protein. If I don't give heat shock, they will not express. If I give cold shock, they will not express either. It's only under the positive regulation. The third one is negatively regulated. Negatively regulated means under normal circumstances, the promoter is expressed. The gene is expressed all the time. The promoter is linked to the gene, the protein will be expressed. However, when you give a certain cue, it will be switched off. So, negatively regulated is the example of a promoter which is turn off the gene rather than turn on. The first one is turn on and the second one is turn off.
Like feedback loop.
Like it's a feedback loop. So, the first one will be positively regulated. A good example is IPTG. When you have E. coli growing in your cell culture, you add IPTG, they will immediately express the protein after a certain lifetime. The negatively regulated promoters, the gene is being expressed in the organism. But however, when you give the signal, or the, you add a certain chemical, it will switch off the gene. So that's why it's called negative regulation. It will switch off. And the multi-regulated, regulated by multiple factors. So these are very good to develop biological circuits because you can have a promoter which will be switched on by temperature as well as by chemical. So only when you, for example, you are growing E. coli 37, I lower the temperature to 15, okay? So that will switch on the gene. However, I need another chemical, so I add glucose. So glucose and 15 degrees both together will switch on the gene. If the temperature drops and there's no glucose, there'll be no gene. So that's multi-regulated. You need to have two of them working together. So that's a multi-regulated promoter. Is it clear?
Multi-regulated can switch on.
No, multi-regulated means you need to have two people to agree. It's like this. Suppose you want to go next door using your car. Okay? And then you need to have two people to agree to sit in the car to go. That's the rule. Okay. So you need to have two. In this case, it's you need to have two of those factors in order to switch on or switch off the promoter. So multi-regulated promoters are regulated by two chemicals, or maybe two different environments. One may be temperature, other one may be a chemical. For instance, you add glucose, reduce the temperature to 15, the gene will be expressed. If you reduce the temperature to 15, but no glucose, no expression. So if you do one of them, the reason why you see this is because these are more like electronic circuits. In electronic circuitry, you have AND, you know, logic. You have AND, so A and B, then you'll have C. If A not B, then there'll be no C. Or B not A, no C. Okay, so that's the way it works. Multi-regulation. So this is very important because in nature, in our living system, most of the promoters are multi-regulated. You need to have multiplicity of factors which to regulate most genes. Okay, these are regulated promoters. So promoters have strength. Okay? Some promoters are strong promoters, some are weak promoters. Now in living systems, the strength of the promoter determines its utility. For under certain circumstances, a strong promoter may not be good. And under certain circumstances, a weak promoter also may not be good. For instance, if you are an industrial biotechnologist, you want to produce protein in the fermenter using yeast, bacteria, or other cell line. You need to have a strong promoter because you need to increase efficiency. Okay. The other aspect is this. Suppose you are working in vivo system. If you have a strong promoter, you know what will happen? You'll have overexpression of certain genes. When a gene is overexpressed in a system, it will utilize all the amino acids, all the nucleotides. So the other genes will be imbalanced. There will be an imbalance in the cell. So under certain circumstances, you need to have weak promoters. Now the way you determine the strength of the promoters is by using a specific assay. So this is an example of how the assay is used. When you want to use a promoter, you need to have a signal associated with it. Usually, when you express gene in bacteria, it's very hard to see the signals unless you run a gel. So when you see a gel, you can quantitatively estimate the amount of protein. However, there is an alternative way. What you need to do is you take your promoter binding site, you fuse it to a fluorescent protein. The green fluorescent protein or the chromo protein. You put it in bacteria and then you induce. Suppose the promoter is strongly induced, the fluorescence will be more intense. So you can estimate the fluorescence using a simple illuminator or a spectrophotometer. You can use a spectrophotometer, measure the promo protein, measure the fluorescence, and then you can get an idea of whether the promoter is a strong promoter or a weak promoter. So all you need to do is fuse a gene, which is a fluorescent protein or a promo protein, to a promoter. And inside, when you have these together, you can determine the strength of the promoter. So researchers use this approach to determine the strength of promoters, which you isolate. For instance, when you do genome sequencing projects, you will identify many promoters in different systems, in yeast, in E. coli, in humans. But you need to know, you want to know whether they are strong or they are weak, because they are derived it from nature. The way you do this is by fusing them to proteins. A protein which is visually perceptible, you can see the protein. So when you express, induce expression, the fluorescence increases or decreases. We have some examples of this in our lab. We have fluorescent proteins which will express in response to certain cues, like temperature. So this is an example of a fluorescent protein. The fluorescent protein, as you can see, is from our lab, so it's growing on a plate. So when you want to visualize the fluorescent protein, you expose it to blue light, and it will emit the fluorescence, which is green. This is another example of fluorescent protein. So you can see the plate on the left side is basically not expressing. There are bacteria there. Whereas on the right side, you see the fluorescent protein being expressed in response to certain cue. So you can take the plates, for instance, fluorescent proteins, right, will express, the ones which you develop in our lab will express in the cold. They are designed to express in the cold. They will not express at 37 degrees, they will only express in the cold. You have to switch the promoter, which is upstream of the gene. So the promoter binding site is different, so they will only express in the cold, not in the heat. So if you are in for next semester, I'm sure how this is done in the next molecular biology techniques too. Okay, now this, as I told you, designing promoter binding site, all you need is two oligos, forward and reverse. You put them in the tube, in a PCR tube, and then you denature, and you'll denature, and you'll have your promoter block. So this promoter block, you can use ligase and join it to gene. Okay, this is how we design. I'll give an example. So we have two complementary sequences. You synthesize them, you anneal them, and you will have your promoter binding site. Ribosome binding site similar. So you need to have a ribosome binding site after a promoter binding site. What will be the result if I fuse a promoter binding site to a gene of interest without a ribosome binding site?
Protein
will not be expressed. What will I get? The end product?
The gene.
You'll get a RNA.
Yeah.
So if I have a promoter binding site, so the RNA polymerase will bind, and then I'll have a RNA molecule, no protein. I need a ribosome binding site. So as you can see, this is the conserved ribosome binding site. It's AGG, and it's located 6 bases upstream of the start codon. Now this is bacterial. In eukaryotes, it will be different, and it's variable. So eukaryotic promoter binding sites may be located far upstream of a gene of interest. So we have to determine these by using bioinformatic approaches. This is the general rule for bacteria. So these are some of the different versions which were obtained using bioinformatics search. So this promoter binding site is actually called the, you have that promoter binding site, and then you have your Shane-Dalgarno sequence. That's where your RBS will actually bind. So this is a diagram which shows you the most frequently occurring codon for the binding site, ribosome binding site. Do you know what it represents? How do you interpret this diagram? You'll come across it in bioinformatics if you study. Ever you take up bioinformatics, so you... What's that diagram representing? So you have A, T, and G. So this represents the frequency of that particular nucleotide when they analyze a multiplicity of RBS, ribosome binding sites. So they have taken a multiplicity, maybe thousands or millions of RBS, and what they found out is at this position, T and G is always present. So it's 100%. So you see T and G very the size, the magnitude, and then you see A, G, and T. Usually this, in this case, majority is A, minority is G and T in that order. So T is the least represented. So if you look through bacterial promoter binding, RBS, you will see a promoter binding site, and you will see an RBS, you will find the frequency of that particular code. And the rest are all variables. So this indicates the frequency of each. So the size, the magnitude indicates the frequency of that particular nucleotide in that position. Okay, these diagrams are very common in bioinformatics. You see them, given certain genes, they will have certain frequency of usage of nucleotide based on the...
So, doctor, the highest one, ATG, is the highest frequency.
A will be at the highest frequency, G and T, which are below that, will be at lower frequencies. The smaller ones which you see, and the T and G are obviously 100%. They are always found in all genes. Okay.
Highest frequency of?
Frequency of occurrence. What they did is they go through the ribosomal database, for example, RBS, binding site database. They will compile all of them together, they do the statistical analysis to find out which is, they see each position. So zero position will have A, G, or T in that order. Position one will always have T. Position two will have G. So that's a statistic analysis. For instance, they analyze the population and they find out at age 15, people will start using this technology. Okay, that's a frequency of usage, right? So this is the frequency of occurrence. That's the way they use. Is it clear? You understood the concept of this diagram? It's important because you'll come across it in your, in overall, in your, you can use bioinformatics. Is clear concept? Okay. Now, as I mentioned to you, riboswitches, some of the riboswitches, right, are based on the RNA hairpin. Now, a riboswitch is something which is turned on or turned off in the presence of certain environmental cues. Okay. So, riboswitch is a configuration of the RNA. You all have heard of riboswitch? Never heard. Did not hear about riboswitches. Okay. A riboswitch is, as I mentioned to you all, and you have your RNA transcript. Okay, your RNA transcript. RNA assumes a secondary structure based on the internal Watson-Crick base pairing. For instance, if the RNA became a hairpin, your transcript from your gene is actually emerging like this. It's linear, except there's a hairpin. What will happen if the ribosome, when it reaches this point?
Stop.
It will stop. The ribosome will stop, and you won't have complete translation of this protein. Now look at it in terms of riboswitch. What if I could enable this hairpin to become linear by changing the temperature? This hairpin, for instance, the cell is growing at 27 degrees centigrade. Okay. At this point, you have this. When I increase the temperature of the cell to 42 degrees centigrade,